A breeze. The wind. Strong winds. Angry winds. A typhoon. Rain. Heavy patters. Pouring skies. A storm. Harsh marine weather. Heat. Dry spells. Humid days. Blazing fires. The big burning sun. Through all weather, any weather, Colourbond stands through it all for you. Colourbond, made from Australian technology, tested in the harshest weather. Colourbond, strong and beautiful.
For me, the pull of the Australian landscape is that it's got this beaten, weathered harshness, which is contrasted by these beautiful colours and soft matte surfaces. I love how a matte surface holds light, how it diffuses the light. It's absolute joy to photograph. It's like Colourbond steel matte. It's strong, enduring, yet subtle in its beauty.
Thank you. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to the last session of ASA International Forum 2018. Every year, ASA Forum is a much-awaited activity as we are honored to have international speakers sharing the ideas behind their inspirational works. My name is Nawanwat Yutanahat.
And I am Payap Pakdi Lau, and we're both very, very happy to be here with you until the very last event today.
As I'm sure you already know, the agenda of the Architect Expo this year is beyond ordinary. We point our focus to vernacular architecture via a deeper and a more critical interpretation of it. As a result of globalization and the fast-changing world that we live in today, vernacular architecture is consequently at risk of being reduced to just something of local nostalgia. It sometimes gives us an image of a thing of a past, something which is not capable of adapting or evolving, and as a result, quite irrelevant to today's context. But some people may advocate for its inherent adaptable, considerate, and a very people-conscious qualities that we architects in the modern day can learn from and adapt to today's context. So we want to look at these qualities which make vernacular architecture unique, whether it's the construction techniques, the application of local materials, or the thorough understanding of the local context, environmentally, socially, culturally, as the generators of form. And in other words, all of the qualities which result in the affordable and often sustainable buildings, and the exciting array of shapes and forms that varies across the world.
And this year, ASA International Forum 2018 is honored to present lectures from five renowned architects from different continents, different countries, and different backgrounds, starting with Manuelle Gautrand from France, Chang Yunho from China, Christian Prech from Austria, Han Timoturkin from Turkey, and David van Severen from Belgium. Their diverse projects and outlooks shall contribute to the ever-evolving debates on the vernacular.
Before we introduce our last speaker of this year, please allow me to remind you again to please switch off your mobile phone. For those of you who's using the translating headsets, please also adjust the volume to an appropriate level so that it doesn't disturb the audience sitting next to you. And lastly, you can get your parking card stamped at the front of the hall later on.
Okay, that was very important. And now let's begin. The speaker, our last speaker of this year, is Manuelle Gautrand, a prominent French architect who in 2017 received the prestigious European Prize for Architecture. Manuelle Gautrand graduated from École Nationale Supérieure d'Architecture in Montpellier, in 1985, and worked for different architecture studios before establishing her own practice, Manuelle Gautrand Architecture, based in Paris in 1991. Her projects span a diverse range from cultural facilities and offices to housing and commercial and leisure facilities. And her clients include large public institutions, as well as private clients in France and other countries, including Thailand.
Now, please allow me to quote something very interesting from the firm's official website, which is the founding principles of Gautrand's architecture is to re-enchant the city, to bring emotion, to reinvent, to renew, to innovate, to propose the unexpected answers. Gautrand's buildings are bold, non-conforming, and poetic. They embrace the variety of forms and colors and also express a specific relationship to the site.
In addition to this, her solo and joint exhibitions have been exhibited at the Centre Pompidou Metz Swiss Architecture Museum in Basel and the Venice Architecture Biennale. Manuelle Gautrand has been active in teaching and giving lectures around the world. I hope you can join me in welcoming Manuelle Gautrand.
Hello. So to begin, I would like to thank you very much to welcome me and to invite me to this lecture. I have prepared something. The first slides are linked to the city. I think it can be an introduction following that has been said a few minutes ago. Yes, I like very much the cities, and I think that as architects, we are more and more involved in the future of our cities. Myself, I'm traveling a lot, and I like to discover different types of cities. To come back in, for example, Europa, to think about the future of our cities in a very contextual way. And I think that it's very important sometimes to look at work made by artists. This one is made by a Japanese artist who has created a lot of collage of cities. The first slide on the left is expressing the fact that I'm working mainly inside the center of the cities, but more I'm doing new projects. I'm realizing also that there is something else which is very characteristic in my work. It's the fact that most part of my projects are refurbishments, more and more. It can be extension added to existing building, it can be simple refurbishments, or it can be pieces of architecture which are inserted into a very dense context inside the heart of a city. So it's always in my work, and I think it will be the future for a lot of architects. The work is mainly dedicated to how we can add a contemporary piece into an historical city close to very beautiful old buildings. There is always this comparison between old and new. And I think for an architect, it's really great to work adding new contemporary architecture facing old, because we have to be polite, we have to be full of respect. But in the same time, there is a way to create a dialogue between this old architecture and our new one. We have, I think, to keep our freedom, to keep our personality, but to never forget this link between our project and the context. I have selected, I think, 4 or 5 slides on which I would like to speak a little bit. The first one, and its characteristics that you will perhaps see in my work. The first one is the Centre Georges Pompidou in Paris, which is definitely my favorite building in Paris. And one of the reasons is the fact that I think that public spaces are hugely and deeply important in a city. I think that the public space is the way that all the relationships are created. It's really the physical space where all the inhabitants are moving, sharing, discussing, discovering a city. It's always also a place where the building can be really emphasized. And for example, the Centre Georges Pompidou, it's very important to notice that the site dedicated to the competition was the full site, and Piano and Rogers decided in 1976 just to build in 50% of the site to keep a big void, which is today great because it's a magnificent plaza, emphasizing the architecture of the project. It's a very generous place. It's a place also where the program, which is inside the building, is going outside. It's a sort of dialogue place where the art pieces can move from inside to outside. So it's a sacred place which really improve the quality of the building. And when I'm doing architecture, when I have projects, I always take care about how I will create a relationship with the city, with the plaza, the esplanade, the streets, which will face the architecture that I will build. So there are the objects of the architecture, but there are also the voids, which are really filling the city. And for me, the voids are quite even more important than the architecture itself. The second slide is about emotion in architecture. I think that it's very important to avoid creating mainstream architecture or generic architecture. I think one of the goals of the architecture is also to keep the objective of creating emotion. I must say that I'm doing a lot of cultural equipments, so it's more than crucial in a cultural equipment to be dedicated to a form of art, but it's also very important to make in sort that the architecture itself can give emotion, can create a strong remembering for the users. And I show some an art piece. This one is made by Soulage. It's a French painter who is only painting with the black color. So just a few minutes ago, I listened at Chris Precht, who said that architects are always, I mean, most part of the time in black. So I'm not, because I'm not sad inside, perhaps. But so I was never really impressed by the black, and with this painter, I was definitely impressed by the black color too. I love all the colors, and I discover how much art pieces can give emotions, even black paintings, because you have a lot of reflects. The black can become even white, gray, full of colors. But it's important that as artists, perhaps, we keep the strengths and the goal to give emotion to the inhabitants. Architects are not totally artists, but we have to keep a sort of link to artists, a link to the question of the emotion that each citizen has to get moving in a city. Yes, importance of color. I have a lot of colors in my projects. I think that the architecture is about so many fields, but I never forgot the question of the color because it's linked to the light. Sorry, I think there are some perturbations, so I don't move. This art piece is made by Olafur Eliasson. It's a Danish artist. I really love his work, and this piece is in Aarhus. It's an art piece which is really in the middle of architecture and art, so you move inside. It's a sort of ring, a glassed ring, suspended on the rooftop, and there is nothing inside, no program, just an empty space where you are really full of emotions, precisely because it's like a rainbow and you go through all the colors that you can imagine. And you could anticipate that there is not so many emotions because it's only about colors, but in fact you have deep emotions because you see all your city areas through those multicolored filters, and each filter gives a sort of different feeling of the city. So it's a wonderful piece of art. Number four is about the importance of natural light and the sustainability. I must say that I was born in Marseille, in the south of France, close to the Mediterranean, which is for me the most beautiful sea in the world, because in a way it's a small sea, and all the countries all around Mediterranean have for me a specific natural light, which is very bright, very powerful, very contrasted. And I kept in mind the light that I have discovered when I was young, and I always try in my projects to give a strong importance to the natural light, because all the places that we are creating as architects, it's places that we have to sculpt with the natural light. It can be made in a very generous way, but it can also be made in a more delicate way, depending of the program. But I have always a lot of decisions about the way to sculpt the natural light in my projects. And the last picture is about, number five, a project that gave me one of my strongest emotions as a young architect. I mean, I was not an architect at this time. I decided to go all around the world. I was 19. It was just in the beginning of my studies of architecture. And I discovered in Sydney the opera made by Jørn Utzon. And it was a shock. I was totally astonished with the beauty of this building, interior, exterior, the huge scale of the opera, but in the same time, the small scale of the details. You will see that later. I have some other pictures. And I realized that architecture can really give emotion. Architecture has also to be expressive. We have to keep our own personality, and I think it's very important during this period, because we are full of images when you are looking at Instagram. We have so many possibilities to see architecture. And beside that, we have absolutely to keep and to sculpt our own personality. We have to be influenced, but not so much. I have some pictures of my office from far away and from inside. I show those pictures because it's very important to notice that we are doing a lot of models in my office. The size of the office is not so big. We are between 20 and 30, approximately 28 currently, and we are keeping a small size of office. We are, I think, very close together. It's like a big family. We are working really hard. And because we are working hard, it's important to play also with architecture. Doing models, physical models, it's a way, of course, to be more clever in choosing the guideline in our projects. We are testing a lot of solutions when we are doing a competition or a feasibility study. But it's also a way to be very instinctive and to play with architecture. We like the fact that when we are doing models, physical models, we are like children. So we like to use new materials, we like to test scenarios which are unexpected. It's always a very playful moment in the conception of a project. So we have a lot of physical model. In the middle, it's the model of a project that we are currently developing in Amsterdam, in Holland. The master plan has been made by MVRDV, Winimas. I think we are a little bit close together, because we are also trying to do, most part of the time, a playful architecture. The first project that I will show is a cinema that we have finished 1 year ago. It's in Paris, really in the center of the city. And you can see the site, which is this one. It's an old cinema, and we were involved in this project to refurbish strongly the existing building. In fact, it's more like a demolition and a new construction. We are facing a church in a very important axe in Paris. And the goal of the client was to rebuild 8 rooms while creating a sort of cultural equipment. There is a tradition in Paris to have a lot of cultural equipments. And the first two images are very important because it's the Opéra de Paris. When you look at the sections of this old building, you can immediately realize that the common facilities, the sharing spaces, the bracing spaces for the public are quite more important in terms of proportion than the inside of the main theater. And I think it's very important to keep this big proportion because visiting and living 2 or 3 hours in a cultural equipment, you go there to see a movie, you go there to see a theater piece, but you go also there one more time to have emotion, you have to be prepared. It's a very specific moment. You are lucky to live this moment. And it's very important to have a lot of places to share this opportunity. So for those cinema, we wanted absolutely also to have this idea of creating a lot of sharing spaces. The client also wanted for this cinema to be both a cinema and a place for events. So during the evenings is dedicated, of course, to cinema, but during the day they rent the place to lectures, to conferences, to a lot of Parisian events. So it was also very important to emphasize the dimension and the proportion of the common facilities. We have made a lot of physical models, and I don't know, I think you have also this problem in Thailand, but in France we had a lot of cinema in the suburbs, which were during the past decades sort of shoe boxes, like a shopping mall, like a factory. And we wanted for this specific project to invent it really as a cultural facility, a very exclusive and sophisticated cultural facility. So I wanted to express the stairs that you can see inside the room itself. I wanted for the stairs to be visible from the underneath part of the room, and I wanted absolutely to extend the stairs outside the room, to have a sort of indoor cinema, but also an outdoor cinema in the atrium. So we have sculpted the place, mixing stairs, amphitheaters, escalators, in a lot of different ways, inside a huge atrium, which is 25 meters high. And the different amphitheaters each time are moving up from up to down, so you are accessing, you are entering inside the atrium from the upper part, you are going down the amphitheater, entering into the room. So there is a sort of scenography in the different promenades. And sometimes you get a sort of vertigo. It's really a beautiful space which is sculpted in a way in 3D. And you have a lot of events which are or extract of movies which are put on the walls. All the space is gray, and you can see partly the movie before entering inside the room. So the cinema and the movies are everywhere, even before entering inside the room. That is a section we wanted for the place really to be very compact and to allow this very big atrium. where everybody can share the place. That is some of the common facilities, the interior of the rooms. And now I would like to speak about the facade. There is also a tradition in Paris to have a sort of expression of the cultural equipment, which are visible and which are with a different architecture compared to all the housing, the Haussmannian style that we can see everywhere in the center of Paris. So there is a tradition of very powerful cultural equipments, and I wanted to create this time a powerful facade expressing the movies themselves. I'm sorry for the perturbation. I was impressed by the film Blade Runner that you can remember in the middle. So I wanted for the facade to be totally filled with LED, not with a huge screen, but in a much more poetic way. I wanted for it to express the movie, one movie or several movies. The first picture is over there. And we have made a lot of mock-ups. The result is this one. So we wanted for the LED to be very dense in the middle of the facade, and more you are going close to the neighbors, less the LED are dense. It's like a sort of lace of LED. And in the middle, the result is the fact that the picture is very detailed, and more you are moving close to the borders, less the pictures is visible. So it was a way to create a poetic LED facade. And it's created with a sort of stripes going down from the roof to the first level. And we wanted for the stripes to be ended with a beautiful marquise, which is another tradition. A marquise is a sort of cantilever protecting the pavement facing the entrances. We wanted for the public to be enveloped with the LED, to be like covered by the extremity of the facade before entering inside the theater. You can see different pictures expressing the marquise and the different densities of the LED. And the result with the marquise, it's a way also to create some troubles, because you don't see so much the movie which is inside. You discover some details. It's also a sort of artistic way of discovering the picture and the movie inside. The second project that I would like to show is another cultural equipment in the north part of France. It's in Lille. There was a beautiful museum made by Roland Simounet. And it's not an old building. It has been made during the 90s. But the building is really beautiful, and quite immediately it was listed. So it was a protected building. And the monumental authorities decided to create a lot of constraints when I had to think about the extension. The curator of this museum had a beautiful collection of contemporary art and modern art, and the goal of the competition was to refurbish the existing museum made by Roland Simounet, but also to extend it welcome a collection which is very special. It's an outsider art collection. I don't know if you know about outsider art. I will show some pictures. It's this form of art. It's a very specific art, mainly most part of the time made in hospitals by people who are not artists or who don't want to be specifically artists. They are just working on themselves. So you have a lot of different types of arts. It's most part of the time made with recycled papers, objects. Those forms of arts are very fragile. And I must say that sometimes the collections which are shown there are a little bit violent, because really it's a sort of very specific art made by people sometimes which have big problems. So they have to express through art pieces which are most part of the time absolutely marvelous. And it has inspired a lot of modern artists like Dubuffet, like Picasso. And mainly the modern art was really influenced by those pieces of art. So the goal of the curator was to create an extension where displayed, of course, the outsider art, but in the same time, the curator wanted for the people not to discover immediately which piece of art was contemporary art, modern art, or outsider art. He wanted to mix everything, to give a sort of very intuitive feeling between those forms of art, and to get the visitors a little bit lost. It's also a way to better respect the outsider arts. So the monumental authorities wanted absolutely for this extension to keep a distance with the existing building. And I decided not to respect this regulation, because I wanted really for the three forms of art to be totally linked, and I decided to do this sort of very special shape, like that. We have made a physical model, and it's like you can see it's like two arms enveloping the existing building made by Roland Simounet. It was also a way to say to the existing building that I love it, so I wanted to embrace it in a very gentle way, keeping a lot of existing regulations, the scale, the rhythm of the architecture. But I wanted also to keep my own personality while creating my project. So you can see the conceptual way to show it between wood and pink resin. So there is at the end a sort of continuous promenade inside the three forms of art. The site is very narrow here, so it's a sort of two font-shaped volumes which are emerging on the east and on the north. Mainly the pieces of art of the outsider art are here. And the rooms are a little bit more organic than the existing, because precisely I wanted to envelop the outsider art in a very calm and sinuous way, so that the visitors will never discover all the pieces together. There is a sort of rhythm which is created, several rooms, and at the end of each room, you have a sort of breathing space, so that the visitor can have a look on the landscape before entering back and continuing the promenade. That was the phase under construction. I wanted for the building to be very simple, reflecting the outsider art. It's only concrete facades. And because the art is fragile, we used some lace of concrete to envelop the bracing space at the extremity of each room, so that you have a link and a visual link with the landscape, but in the same time you never have the sun inside the rooms to protect from the sun the art pieces. And we had a very delicate work with the scale. We tried to do our best to fit with the scale of the existing building. We are never higher than him. We have a sort of rhythm which is similar. Only the texture and the facade are different, but the respect of the existing building is somewhere else. We didn't try to mimic the existing building, but just to keep our personality and to create a smooth dialogue between them. That is some pieces of the lace of concrete. Roland Simonet has partly been in the north part of Africa. So he was very inspired by the Moucharabieh. And I wanted also to create this lace of concrete to create a link with the past of Roland Simonet and the story that he got in the north part of Africa. So in my opinion, it was a way also to recreate a sort of contemporary Moucharabieh linked with his memories. So it's a sort of mysterious volume enveloping the outsider art, perhaps a little bit less mysterious during the night because it's like a sort of Chinese lamp. The interior, it's a little bit dark to protect the art pieces, but in the meantime you have always windows creating links with the outdoor spaces. And you can see the art pieces, yes. This project is in Béthune. It's a theater. And the particularity of this project is the fact that I have made the project in two phases with a big gap between the two phases, quite 10 years. And the other particularity is the fact that it's in a very small town. And I must say, a very poor town. So they were happy to welcome Centre Dramatique National. It's really a cultural equipment which is organized by the Ministry of Culture in France. They wanted to introduce this cultural facility in Béthune because precisely it's a poor city. With a big industrial crisis, and they wanted to create a sort of important cultural equipment to allow the people to be proud of their city and not to leave the city. So it was a strong point of a strong sharing point in the city. The first stage of the building is Yes, you can see also in this picture. It's this one. It was the first stage. And the second was this one that I have finished three years ago, approximately. Because it's a poor city, the budget was very low. And even if the budget was low, I wanted really to do a powerful object, a colorful object, because also, it's a little bit a sad city. I wanted for the city to be proud of the building and for the building to be really a signage inside the city. You have seen previously that it's a city full of bricks, so there is a sort of tonality which is made of brown, red, orange, and I wanted also to play with this very important color for the city. But the material is simple, it's only concrete with a lac, a very strong varnish, which is purple. It's also linked to the theater itself because there is a tradition with the French theater using a lot of red. And the extension is this one, the black piece that I have connected to the previous stage. You can immediately remark that the two stages of the project 10 years later are not similar. I didn't want to continue the same vocabulary. I wanted to create a different piece. It's a sort of other vocabulary that I wanted to add on the first one. And the inspiration is coming, it's Soulage. When I discovered the beauty of the black, I wanted in my architecture at a certain point to play with the black. And I have made the project with a very simple black panels. They are successively matte and glossy. I wanted really to recreate this type of reflex. I wanted for the black to be suddenly white, to be black and white, to be green. So I wanted to use both matte and glossy materials, but it's really an industrial material. It's very cheap. So I wanted the maximum of effect with a minimum of money. That's some pictures, and I wanted to create the addition close to the first building in a very simple way. They are just added and aligned. Of course, the two colors are fitting together, but they are not the same. So I wanted, like the directors, like the artists of this theater, I wanted to create a new piece of architecture without mimicking the previous one, just adding a new piece in this small town with a new identity, fitting with the new generation of artists which are working in this cinema. That is the play between the matte and the glossy, and I wanted to use a big lozenge shape so that the natural light is like flowing down between the folds of the metallic panels. Inside, the theater is really black. It's influenced by the German artist called Pina Bausch. So it's a very special theater, and we had for the building inside to be impressed and to be enveloped by this atmosphere, which is sometimes very dark in the theater made by Pina Bausch. So we had really to make in sort that the architecture itself prepare to the event that you will see in the room itself. The goal for the extension was to create a sort of rehearsal, which is both a place where the artists can prepare themselves to the event, but that it's also a secondary theater place where the public is sometimes welcome in a very simple way, and the public is really mixed with the artists in a sort of dialogue which is really close together. It's not face-to-face, there is no hierarchy in this place between the artist and the public. It's another way to play theater. That is a project that I am trying to do in Israel. I have made an exhibition 10 years ago. I was invited to exhibit my work in Israel, and sometimes later, the mayor of this town, Ashkelon, came in Paris and asked me if I was interested to build and to work on a program which is very special. We called Art and Music Center, but in fact it's a little bit more. It's a place dedicated to all forms of art. It's a contemporary conservatory for theater, dance, music, singers, sculpture, and theater. I don't remember if I said it. And it's dedicated for students, but also, of course, for big events. And the goal is really for the students to be able to discover all the forms of art in this place. The city of Ashkelon is facing the Mediterranean. It's a very heterogenic city. That is the grid that we have made. When we are doing a project in the office, we have always two types of work. We are working deeply on the site, trying to be deeply impressed like a sponge by the roots of the site. It can be social roots, cultural roots, geographical roots, the light, the atmosphere that you can feel in the city before building something in it. And we are also always doing a big work on analyzing the program. We are convinced that sometimes the client, they have a program, but they didn't explore their own program at the extremity. There are sometimes perhaps not enough inventive. And when we are beginning a project, we are always trying to push them, having new ideas, pushing themselves, their program, more far away, in a more innovative way, anticipating in a more clever way the new users. So we are always trying to work on grids, creating a dialogue with the client, working on the program itself, before working on the project itself. We have made several physical models, but first of all, I have to say that we had a huge constraint, which is the fact that in Israel, it's still a sort of continuous war. And for all the public equipment, we have to take care of the public. And we have to, beside all the elements of the program, we have to integrate a lot of shelter rooms, which are built to prepare in case of an attack. And each shelter has to be very close to each public room. So at the end, if we wanted to create our building in a very horizontal way, we had to create something like 15 shelters, which was a lose of space. So we decided to work in a much more vertical way, to avoid having too much shelter rooms, also to create a sort of vertical circulation, a very compact one, so that all the people, when they are playing some music or doing some sculpture or improving some theater, they will share together the different forms of art. And in this case, because of this vertical circulation, which is very compact, we have added all the shelter rooms together, one upon the other. And at the end, we had only 5 shelter rooms to create instead of 15. So we have created a sort of trunk, a huge atrium, which is 33 or 35 meters high. Inside, we have spread all the vertical circulations, and around this trunk, like branches, you have all the volumes, and each volume is really fitting precisely the proportion of the ideal program for a theater, for an artistic place to sculpt, for a place where you have to play your instrument in a very personal way. So each program is really fitting the proportion and the scale, and it's directly fixed to the main core. And this sculpture, which is very irregular in a way, it was also a way for us to create a lot of outdoor places. Each terrace is accessible and is dedicated to an outdoor place. So you have always the indoor place, the outdoor place. It was also a way to double the capacity of the program, because in this project, like the previous theater, the client, which is the municipality of Ashkelon, they don't have too much money. So we wanted in a generous way to double the surfaces. And because the weather is very smooth, we wanted for each indoor space to have the possibility to extend in an outdoor terrace. Which is most part of the time, of course, protected from the sun. So you are working in a place which has a shadow and it's not so hot. That is one of the terraces protected. You can have really outdoor events. You can have really the possibility to share also the view. And it can be also places only not for events, but just to rest or to work or to have schools. And the notion of shadow is very important because of the very hot weather that you get during the summer. That is the plan for the core with the shelters. I think it's somewhere here. And we have also decided to sculpt this atrium. It's like a concrete sculpture where the promenades are always different, the stairs are organized always in a different way. And it will be ready for artistic installation. We would like for some artists to be able to play with this atrium and to put giant art pieces, which can be multimedia, which can be music. And that is the final result. That is an office building. We are leaving the cultural equipment, an office building that I have made in a city in the middle of France. It's called Saint-Étienne. It's the red circular piece that you can see on the right slide. There was a very special particularity in the program. We had to do offices for something like 12 different tenants. And when we have done the competition, none of them knew in advance how many square meters they will at the end. So it was very difficult for us to conceive this project. The other constraint was the fact that the municipality wanted absolutely to keep a lot of transparencies because it's a very dense program. And beside that, the municipality, even if it's dense, the municipality wanted for us to keep promenades through the building, to keep visual links between north and south, east and west. So we had both to create a dense project without knowing how to dispatch to organize different tenants. And we have also we had also to keep this promenade and to create a sort of porous project. So our idea was to create a sort of continuous volume going up and down. And I must say that I was a little bit afraid with the density because I wanted for all the offices to be able to catch a lot of natural light. So it's two layers of architecture. When the first one is up, the second one is down at the back. And when the first one is down, the second one is high. It was also a way to catch the natural light, but to catch the views in a city which is really sculpted with a lot of hills. So the architecture is moving up and down to create hills itself, and also to respect the constraints to have all those pedestrian links from north to south, east to west. And the continuous shape helped us to allow the tenants to choose the number of square meters that they will like at the end, but at the very end of the phase under construction. So the architecture needed absolutely to be continuous. So when a tenant was happy to have more, the previous tenant was a little bit pushed. So it was really a continuous shape, allowing a lot of movements. So sometimes you have very small floors which were dedicated to the common facilities, and sometimes you had more regular floors dedicated to the offices themselves. The phase under construction was very impressive because it was a sort of mix between concrete structure and a metallic structure dedicated to the bridges and to the big cantilevers. We had to create a sort of door facing the center of the city and attracting the people inside the building. So you have a lot of metallic steel structure, which is which is always visible from the inside of the offices. And that is different views that you can catch. When you are in an office, you can see the view through the other layer of architecture, because it creates a sort of huge door on the panorama. And there are a lot of layers like that. And I wanted also to work with color in this project. The weather in Saint-Étienne is most part of the year very gray. And because also of this density, I wanted to use very pale, bright and playful, optimistic color. It's like an artificial sun that I have used for all the courtyard to create a sort of contrasted light, like an artificial sun in the middle of the courtyard. So there are two materials, this yellow color and also all the curtain walls. And I wanted also to work on the question of the reflection. So sometimes and often the curtain wall is really reflecting the yellow surface, and it's a way to double it and to create also a very special atmosphere where everything is as yellow reflects. You can see that the courtyard is narrow. There is a lot of shadow inside. So the yellow was really essential for me to be, of course, in a sort of shadowed street, but in the same time, a very playful and joyful space. And you have a lot of movies which use the space, because it's really sculpted, and Saint-Étienne, the town, is very proud of this building. That is a competition that I have won also a few years ago in Stockholm. Stockholm is a city which is a social democracy, and we have to negotiate everything before building a project. So we are negotiating since 3 years the future of this building. This building is a beautiful one in the middle of the city. It's a brutalist architecture made by architects called Tangbaum and Salomon. And they have made this place which is in the same time powerful, but in the same time a little bit alone in a site without creating a lot of dialogue with the context. So the goal is to think about the future of this project, respecting the fact that it is also a listed building, so we have to keep the powerful atmosphere of this brutalist architecture. But in the same time, we have to make it a little bit more generous, more open to the neighbors. And we are allowed, if we succeed into opening the building, creating a lot of links, improving the arrondissement, improving the district all around the building, we will be allowed to extend on the top of the building and to create a new office building on the roof. I have, I know Stockholm, of course, a little bit now, and this picture in the middle is not the best one, but Stockholm has a beautiful skyline, like most part of the European cities, which is made with sculpted roofs, sometimes very old sculpted roofs. And this building, our building, is beautiful, but it's a period where architects were working a lot with flat roof. And on the top of this building, there is only technical rooms. So my first goal was to respect this building, but in the same time, perhaps to add something on it, which could reinterpret the beautiful skyline of Stockholm made with beautiful folded roofs. And I have added something like that, a folded architecture, mimicking in a way or playing with the folded roofs that you can find in Stockholm. So the result is this one. The first sketches were this one, the idea of moving up from a very powerful architecture full of concrete to a smoother architecture, much more transparent, to create contrast and not to play with the same vocabulary, and an architecture which is delicate, which only touch the existing building on some points. I was inspired by a work made by this artist, which is called Peter Callison. He is only working with folding paper, and I must say that I like that very much. So I wanted for the architecture to be like a folded paper, a folded layer added to the existing roof. And the goal was also to keep between the two architectures a sort of bracing space, which will be dedicated to common places. I have the feeling that mainly in our European cities, we have to face the fact that we have to densify the cities, but in the same time, we cannot only live with public spaces which are in two dimensions. So it's very important more and more to think about a three-dimensional public space. And I wanted for this bracing space in the middle of the two architectures to be dedicated most part of the time to public spaces. It's a place where the inhabitants of Stockholm will be able to look at their own city, discover their skyline, and having some gardens in greenhouses, so having cafe, restaurant, and it's also a way for the inhabitants to discover their city from the roofs, to orient themselves inside their city. So that is a different 3D. This picture is important because we wanted for the ceilings of this folded architecture to be covered with mirrors, so that we get the feeling to be in a very high space, even if it's not so high. And we wanted also, because it will be planted with a lot of gardens, we wanted also for the people moving on the pavement to catch the reflect of the gardens when moving inside the streets. That is the place dedicated to a restaurant where the inhabitant will be allowed to really see the main view of Stockholm. I was inspired by everything which is creating the spirit of the Nordic countries. So it's linked to the beautiful colors of the light. It's totally different from the Mediterranean natural light. It's much more subtle, pale, but it's really beautiful too. And I wanted also to play with the question of the snow, with the glass. There was a huge palette of white. And the idea was to create the envelopes of this extension with scales, which are a little bit inclined to maximize natural light inside the offices. And those scales are a little bit reflective. So it's also a way to reflect the clouds and to give a sort of very smooth impress of this extension facing the brutalist architecture that you have on the lower part. We would like also to create the frames of those scales in a very ornamented way, because in Stockholm you have a lot of historical building playing with goldy ornaments, so we wanted also to reintroduce this level of sophistication. And at the end, the inclination of all the scales will maximize natural light inside the offices with 18%. So it's really important for us. We have made a lot of solar studies to be able to be sure about this figure. And adding 18% of natural light is also important to give a lot of flexibility to the office spaces inside. That is the last pictures. And the last project that I would like to show is in Australia. Yes, I had the opportunity to come back in Australia, and it was very important for me to see one more time and to see this fabulous opera. So there are some pictures about it. And as I was saying in the beginning of the presentation, it's very important in my architecture to work on a very faraway scale where you can see the silhouette of your architecture, but in the same time, it's also important to think about the skin itself and to think about a very small scale that you can touch. As architect, we have to think about the urban scale, but also to think about the design scale of materiality that you can be able to touch and to feel. And in the opera, the whole surfaces are covered with tiles, and everything is purely perfect. Anyway, it was a competition that we were invited to do it. In fact, I have done a lecture in Melbourne 4 years ago, and I met some architects, and one of them, after the lecture, said we could collaborate doing some competition sometimes. I said yes. So he called me back 6 months later and proposing me this competition in Parramatta, which is a district in the Great Sydney. It was for a library and the extension of a town hall, and we won the competition. So we have a partner, which is designing, and we are doing this project since now 2 years, so we are close to the beginning of the phase under construction. Parramatta is part of the Great Sydney. Time's up. So I will go faster, sorry. Yes, so just to have a look on the context, Parramatta, it's a city where quite one of the oldest buildings is this one. It's the existing town hall, very pretty Victorian style architecture. And we had to extend this town hall while creating a very important equipment for the city, which is a library. And I was very impressed by the constraint, because when we are working in Europa, we have so many constraints linked to European cities. So an historical building, a very tiny site. There are so many historical constraints, so many regulations. And here, we didn't have so many, but just one, which was to create the project with the sun course. They wanted in Parramatta that the square keep a sort of sunny atmosphere during all the day, all the during all the year and even the lowest day. We had absolutely to keep the plaza very sunny. We were allowed to put a little bit of shadow, but not so much, sorry. So instead of playing with this constraint in a sort of 50 way, we decided really to respect at a maximum point the sun on the plaza, and to sculpt the whole volume of the building with the sun course. And it gave us a sort of shape which is very strange and which is also linked to the program. Because the program is a mix between offices for the councillors, We have also a lot of places dedicated to discussion between the conciliors and the inhabitants. It's a way to create a link between the politicians and the inhabitants. I like the program also for this aspect, because it's a way to create a sort of community inside this town, to be like if you live inside this city, you have really the possibility to participate to all the political decisions. So it's a building where everybody will be able to share with the politic the decision of the city. It's also a building which will envelop exhibition places and this big library. And the idea of the library is to spread the library all over the building from the ground floor to the top floor. So the shape, which is like a triangular shape, is interesting because when you are on the ground floor, the space is very generous, fluid and big. More you are going up, more the space gives you intimacy, the possibility to work or to read in a more calm atmosphere, will give you the possibility to work alone, to be really concentrated. And in the ground floor, you share everything. It can be noisy. So everything is a question of a progression between the ground floor and the upper floor, between something which is very open to something which is very full of intimacy. So we have made a lot of models. We have also embraced and covered the town hall, has to protect it and to create this link, which is also symbolic, between the new extension of the town hall and the old part of it. That is the main picture, which shows the way for the sun course to be sculpted. And because the sun is not totally perpendicular, it's a little bit inclined, we have a lower part which is at the northeast of the volume, and it's a way to create a sort of spire, having a sort of symbolic goal, a sort of signage for the city. You can see the entrances and the parkours moving up. We have a sort of giant stair accompanying all the flows from the ground floor to the top floor. And a way to create a lot of mezzanines. So we want also to get benefit from this sloped roof from the inside. So the people will move in a way from mezzanines to mezzanines. I must say that I have always the wish to work with the floors. I mean how can I say, the masses, but also the voids. I like to work with the feeling of vertigo sometimes. I like to create architecture with a lot of voids, to create a lot of visual relationships between the programs and the people. So we have mezzanines which are full of voids. And that is the way for all the levels to be stepped back, and always getting the possibility to see from one level to the other. We have a lot of amphitheaters playing and mimicking the slope of the roof inside the building. So it's one more time a building which is full of inclined surfaces where the people will be able to work also, just to move, but also to share or to work. And I think I have finished. Yes. So.
Thank you so much, Manuelle, for such a colorful presentation today. from the floor, from our audience, if you guys have questions, our staff will be passing out paper, so you can write your question on that piece of paper and then hand it back to them, and your questions will be delivered to our moderator, and then eventually will be answered by Manuelle.
And please welcome Ajahn Yarinda Bunnak, the moderator for this Q&A session, please.
Hi, Manuelle. Thank you so much for the wonderful lecture. So I can't help wanting to kick off the discussion by talking more about colors. So, you know, like for me at least, I feel like colors is one of the most difficult or one of the more subjective aspects of architectural design, right? So for every project, how do you decide on the best color or the best choice of, you know, combination of colors to use? Do you do a lot of studies? How do you do research? And maybe if you could talk a little bit about that.
First of all, I want to repeat the fact that architecture is a whole. It's about the space, the functions, the users, the way to insert a new piece in an existing city. And when we are thinking about a project, we are always mixing everything, the goals that we give to us about the functionalities, the way to be contextual in the city. But we are always working very soon in the process about the material, the way to catch natural light, to be either very opaque or very transparent, keeping a strong relationship with the outside. We work on transparent materials or translucent materials, mirrors to reflect, to attract, to diffract natural light. And the question of the color is coming in this big field. The choice is, I think, always very contextual, linked to the geography, the culture of the city, the atmosphere of the city. But sometimes it's also a choice which is linked to the users and to the program. In a very provocative way, I could say that sometimes the color is linked to a brand. For example, for the building that I have made on the Champs-Élysées for Citroën, the building is really worked with two colors, white and red, and the red is directly linked to the brand Citroën. So the color can be really linked to the city, to the program, even to a brand, to a specific brand.
Do you do a lot of one-to-one models or tests and studies, especially like some, you know, some of the projects that requires understanding of like light and reflection and refractions?
We are always doing physical models at different scales. Yes, we like to do models. It's like a rest moment in the office. It's either a way to anticipate and to search about something. It's also a way to be confident with what we have done, what we have already done. And we always force ourselves to work in the same time to big models, for example, at the scale 1 to 100 or 1 to 500, but in the same time to detailed models to the scale 1 to 5, because it's also important to play with different scales in the same time, the big one and the small one. And still the beginning, I mean, even at the quite beginning of a project, we can do a model at the scale, not 1 to 1, but 1 to 5. And even in the contrary way, at the quite end of a project, we can just redo a model at the scale 1 to 100, just to test one more time the link for some elements in the architecture, some precise link with the context and yes, and the special relationship that we want to create with the neighbors. So we always mix the scales.
And we see a lot of images of your projects from the outside. We do see a few of the inside, but I'm very curious to hear more about the relationship between the image of the building that is very bold on the outside and the relationship of that to the interior spaces and interior programs.
The interior spaces are, for me, both with the context, the main goal of the project. We like to improve, we like to We like to modify sometimes the program which is given to us. We like to create really a strong and deep dialogue with the clients, and sometimes we are convinced that they have to modify a little bit their program. So we have always a strong work on the program and on the interior spaces. And I think if I can try to find something which is a link between all our projects, we try to create scenographies. Because I have done a lot of cultural equipment, I know that the way to enter in a building and the way to walk inside the building from the quiet beginning to the quiet extremity that we will join, we have to think about all the sequences. And we have to invent for each of them a specific atmosphere. And I must say that the common places in a building, the sharing places, you have always the core of the functions, but you have the circulations, you have the lobby, the resting places, the cafeteria. It's always crucial parts of our projects because it's really the link between the functions. And we want, most part of the time, to increase a little bit the surface of those common facilities because it is a way to be prepared to the function itself and a way to share what you will leave or what you will see in the function itself.
You did mention during the lecture that you also like to challenge the programming of the building, right? And that when you receive a brief from the client, you would like to somehow question some of the given programs. Have you ever managed to maybe totally change the programs of what the client, you know, started out wanting to do and end up with something totally different or, you know?
To totally change, no. But for example, one of the recent projects we are currently doing, the phase under construction, it was a very important project facing a railway station in France. And the client wanted for the project to be only dedicated to hotels. And I thought it was not a good idea to only do hotel because it's, the location is absolutely excellent. We are facing a railway station. We are in the quiet center of the city. And I didn't speak too much about mixed use facilities, but we are doing a lot. And I think that creating an architecture which is dedicated to several functions, mixed together, it's a very rich way to create architecture because you can have common spaces which are dedicated to all the functions. The people can share in a much deeper way. And for this project, we proposed to the client to add dwellings, apartments, and also to add offices. And he agreed with that. And at the end, we have commercial activities, offices, two hotels, and housings on the top. And I think it's much better also in terms of sustainability because we went very far away, very deep in searches about minimizing the use of energy because we are recycling the energy produced during the day by the offices and we give it to the hotel and the housings. So we are working on a project which is always 24 hours a day full of people, which is also very important for me in a city. In Thailand or in Asian countries, I think you are much more used to have cities which are always full of life. But sometimes in Europa, you have cities where you have a place everybody is living inside, a place it's dedicated to offices. And I think it's now we have to move forward to mix the functions. to make in sort that a district is much more full of life all over the day, the night, and the year. And so we got the advantage to minimize in a big proportion the energies, and it gave also us the advantage of creating a sort of iconic building facing the railway station, which is always full of life. And also the programs themselves, the people living inside the apartments, they are happy to use the cafe of the hotel. The offices are happy to use it also. So there are a lot of places which are becoming sharing places for the different programs. And it gave us the possibility of creating a lot of unexpected functions that we didn't anticipate ourselves.
Did you have to use an economic argument to convince the owner, or was it simply about, you know, common goods? And
yes, it was also, I didn't thought about that before, but I must say that he agreed on doing housings, and in the beginning I didn't know why. But the fact is that we could buy the site much higher because building housings gave for the developer much more money than building hotel. So it was really great because I was happy creating a mixed project, much more rich, full of life all over the day. And he was happy because it was a way to buy the site higher, and also to give to me more money to do. I mean, the architecture had the possibility to explore, to have a bigger budget. And it's also important. We are in a situation in France where the projects are sometimes with small budget. I spoke about that several times, but it's important. It's an important point that we have to think about when we are architects. We have to be part of the economic situation of the client of the city. And because our architecture has to keep perenne, we have also to be involved with all the economic part of the architecture. So I was happy to help the developer with this key point because it was a way also to allow me a much more sophisticated architecture.
On a related note, you also mentioned in the lecture that you feel sometimes that the voids are more essential than the architecture itself. How do you, you know, in oftentimes when you get projects, the budget comes with this kind of like estimated GFA, and you have to, you know, you have the plot and you have to build this much. How can you usually convince a client to let you make these voids in the projects?
It's a very good question because it's difficult. Of course, it's difficult for a client sometimes to understand that you will pay for a big envelope and inside you will not have so many square meters. And it's typically the case in Australia because we want to maintain this beautiful relationship that we have between all the levels, and sometimes the quantity surveyor says to the client, you should fill the voids. So, of course, it's a sort of fight, but I think we have a job where we have to fight a lot. I listened at Chris Sprecht lecture, and he said, yes, I agree, we have a very difficult job because it's not only about designing building. We have to be like poet, we have to invent, we have to be very generous, but we have also to fight a lot with everybody, even sometimes with the client, because I'm convinced that we have always to keep a very good relationship with the client. But it doesn't say that we have always to agree with him We have to push him. We have to convince him. So we have to be convinced ourselves. And it's a sort of gentle fight, but it's still a fight. And for example, precisely in Australia, we are fighting exactly currently to keep our voids. For example, the municipality wants to keep them, but the contractor wants absolutely to cancel some of them. And we are in the middle of the battle. And yes, it's a difficult situation, but I'm convinced that we will succeed. Because we have, they argue, a library needs to create a strong relationship between the people. And the relationship, it's also the way to see people from one level to the other, to keep a monumental atmosphere of the building, to be impressed, to get this emotion. I was speaking about that in the beginning. So I'm convinced that we will succeed, but there is always, when we are beginning a phase under construction or when we are beginning to negotiate a bid, there are always a step where we have to fight with a contractor and sometimes also a little bit with a client.
So you founded your office in 1991, mm-hmm. correct? Did you have a vision of how you wanted to practice, how you would like your architecture to be? Or was it something that grew over time and you retroactively, you know, rationalize your vision?
I think that when I began my office, yes, I had ambitions. I wanted to only to work on very creative projects. I'm really interested, as I said in the beginning, to keep a small-scale office, only to work on complex projects which have to play with a lot of goals. And now I have this reputation to work only on complex projects, on very urban projects, and I think it's an advantage because it becomes now natural. People are not coming to me to propose me a sort of generic architecture. I wanted that in the beginning, but I think when you are beginning your practice, you anticipate goals, but not all of them, and you anticipate them also in a very intuitive way. So it was clear in my mind, but not so clear as it is today. I think that it's very important not to anticipate everything also, because I think that architects have to keep like sponges. We have to be very porous. We have to be open-minded. And I don't know if this word is easy to translate a priori, but it's very important as architect to never have any a priori, any anticipated ideas. We have to keep a sort of open-minded spirit to adapt ourselves to a period which is really moving a lot. And I think our success is to keep a very fresh mind, to be flexible, and also to understand always. So we cannot be pretentious. We cannot... Also, there is a question of the style. I mean, you have to force yourself always to begin a new project like a blank page. It's very important for me also not to, yes, to get influenced by previous projects.
I guess like the next question is more of asking for an advice, and I think a lot of people in this room would be curious to hear as well, but how do you think, I mean, just to preface the question, it's becoming more and more difficult, I feel, to for one to develop a unique identity in this Pinterest era when you see so much and you consume so much information from everywhere around the world, right? So when people are starting out forming a company, for example, you know, how do you feel about this idea about developing an identity in relation to this kind of social media and influences that we see all around us?
It's very delicate to say that, but I think that we have to be very porous, as I said, to be inspired and to be very connected to this social media. But in the same time, I think we have to protect ourselves. So we have to look at them, but not so much. We have absolutely to protect our inventivity and to sculpt our own inventivity in a personal way. So we cannot be too much also, we cannot be too much exposed. And I think that architects who are always connected to social media, who are always looking at design, at everything, I don't think it's a good idea. It's very important also to keep a personal way to do architecture and to keep a little bit far away for that. And sometimes in my office, the architects are proposing ideas looking at magazines and so on, and I say to them, no, don't look at that. You have also to sculpt your own personality and to work with me. We have to work all together in the office, but we have also to work in a sort of bubble, which is the office. And we have sometimes to cut the relationship with all the social medias to really invent from each new blank page for each new project something which is totally specific. And I think also to be protected, the solution is to work deeply, as I said, on the program itself and on the site, without being influenced by outside. And I think it's enough to have, if we are really deeply inspired by the context itself of each project, it's enough to be deeply inspired without outside inspirations. But it's difficult, yes.
And last question, because we're running out of time, but on a very similar issue, but in regards to digital tools, because I heard that you put a lot of attention to actually making models and sketches and things like that. How do you feel about designing or starting design immediately using digital tools?
I'm very open-minded because inventing architecture, you can do it with so many tools. So we are ourselves beginning very quickly with digital tools. The only regulation, I mean, the only constraint that I have, that I give always to me and to everybody, is the fact that we have to mix digital tools with hand sketches. I'm drawing a lot myself. And we have to mix that also with physical models. And I must say that also in the office, we write a lot. We are doing workshop, sharing the conception and the beginning of the invention of the projects. And I like to speak a lot. We are a country where we speak. So we like to speak, to share together, because most part of the time, I get the ideas when speaking myself and listening at the other. We discuss everybody, and the ideas are emerging. So it's not only in doing sketches in a sad place or very alone. No, sometimes it's with really discussion that we discover ideas and we really create the beginning of a project. So digital tools is really a small part, which is connected to the physical models, to the discussions, the sketches, and everything is one more time mixed. And for example, when we are stopped because we don't have the good idea, we change the material. So we stop the digital model and we discuss, or we hand sketch, or we are doing something else, and changing the approach helps you finding the solution. But the discussion is very important.
Thank you so much, Manuelle.
Thank you, Manuelle Gautrand and Ajahn Yarinda. Now I would like to invite Ajahn Yarinda to give a token of appreciation to our speaker.
After five inspirational talks, our ASA International Forum has sadly come to a close. Before we officially say goodbye for this year, I would like to ask the chair of the Architect Expo 2018, Assistant Professor Dr. Apiradi Kasemsuk, to give us a closing remark.
Good afternoon. It's actually good evening. The ASA Forum has been inaugurated for over 20 years ago. Over the past two decades, leading minds and principals in the architectural world have been invited to ASA Forum to present their ideas, projects, and working philosophy to a broader audience. This year is no exception. Our esteemed guest speakers included in the order of presentations are David Van Severin from Office KGDBS, Belgium, Han Tumurtekin from Mimata Tasarim Deniz Malik, Turkey, Yang Ho Chang from Atelier Fechang Jiansu, Chris Pitch from Panda Studio, Austria, and Manuelle Gautrand from Manuelle Gautrand Architectures, France. Your presentations presenting diverse projects and attitudes shall contribute to our subject of this year, vernacular architecture, which we try to explore various aspects of this approach within challenges of globalization processes. Your sharing will keep our minds enlightened and inspired. Thank you all for coming to Bangkok and to be a part of our proud ASA Forum tradition. Now, I would like to take this opportunity to thank all ASA Forum working team, starting from Organizing Committee Savitri Paisan Watana, Jacob Gordon-Linsky. This year, moderators and master of ceremony, ASA Forum organizer, KDC, the PR team from Amin Baba, and Boothscope, who have been our main ASA Forum sponsor for the past several years. Last but not least, I would like to thank our growing numbers of audience, old faces, and many new, including designers, architectural practitioners, and students. We are grateful for your support. I hope you enjoyed our event and look forward to seeing you again next year at Architect Expo and ASA Forum 2019. Thank you. Have a safe trip home.